each dance is a minute. A minute, okay? And it's $60 a dance for a minute. And it's like a group class. And you have no sheet or any feedback. And then there's the bus trip up, and then there's the rooms, and then they want you to buy this package where you eat breakfast, lunch, and dinner with them, like why? And the $250 banquet that they have. And I have no problem paying, you know, part of my instructor's hotel and food. I mean, that's part of what we get too, but I just said, you know what? When I went to the Friday night party and dancing, and I was trying to show him how to do the waltz, which is slow, and he fell down. I mean, literally fell down on the floor. And I'm like, okay, never mind. You don't need to learn to dance. Aww. The only couples I know that dance together is Steve and Debbie. And Debbie still takes lessons with the pro to compete with. Steve has no interest in competing. Fishing like once or twice a year. We have some other friends from Ohio, and they come down and go with them. My husband used to go diving, but he can't dive anymore because of his high blood pressure. So we go snorkeling with Peanut Island. That's been fun. Yes, he's still a little stiff there. He'll bring the neck left. He doesn't want to bring that right shoulder over. So feel like you can move the shoulders a bit over to the inside as you push the ribs out. There's better, yeah. It's really more important there, Tara, to make sure that outside shoulder moves than just the neck.
Okay.
Yeah. a little harder for him to stretch that right side. That's a draw. Okay, that again, you've got to make sure that right shoulder comes in, so in the change he doesn't push the hips left. Until just a little, wants to be a little short. I mean, the change was clean, but you're still losing a little bit of expression there. And then when he lands, he's a touch crooked. You can really feel that right shoulder stay off the rail. What happens when he lands?
Yeah.
The change was better though. Change was better. Mm-hmm, that change is good. Now think about riding it forward up into that outside ring. Forward, straight. Good, okay. Good mistake. Exactly, but the one tuck piece, that was a good mistake because he was nice and straight and balanced. Of course, it wasn't what we wanted, but that's a much better mistake than a crooked change, you know? So at the horse show, maybe you have to have a little crooked change to make sure he stays on that.
Okay.
But at home, don't sacrifice that. At home, really go for the correct feeling. Uh-huh. And if he makes mistakes, he makes mistakes. Good. Again, you know, we keep going back to all the one tempies where we have issues, and that's going to be an issue. So we might as well fix it now. Mm-hmm. Keep the connection. Mm-hmm. Good. Try to just a little more weight in your snaffle ring so he stays a little more up into the snaffle. He kind of bobs a little bit off and on that snaffle ring. You want him to be a little more stable in that contact. Yeah, that's okay. That was his idea. Yay. Keep the snaffle. Keep it. Better. Mm-hmm. Good. Just a little, bring the neck a little more up. Yeah, let's experiment with a little bit higher neck. Ah. Good. He may feel like he's not quite as supple up there.
No.
But that's okay. Let's keep it up there a little bit. And just try to get him a little bit quieter. He's not bouncing his head.
Good job. Better.
Yeah. So here's, I think, where you may have to have a difference with him between this is where I train him and this is where I show him. You know, if you ride him a little deeper to keep him a little bit more supple, then I totally get that, and I think that's an important idea. But I also think that for showing, I don't know, for me the comment's gonna be that maybe the neck's a little too low, and that doesn't even bother me as much as that he likes to bounce his head a bit. So I think maybe at the show, if he's a little higher, a little more up into the snaffle, and he's a little quieter in the contact, and you just kind of live with, oh, he doesn't feel quite as supple, but he's quieter. I think for the 7 minutes of the test, it's gonna be better.
Okay.
I don't know, that's my kind of my opinion, I think. I'm not sure what you think. Yeah, yeah. Bouncing head bothers her too, so. Good job. Okay, so that being said, you can put him a little deeper now for the training. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So every day, just a little bit in the canter, ride him up, so he kind of gets used to it.
Okay.
Yeah, and you kind of get used to that feeling too. I know when he's up there, it's like you're kind of riding like, this feels a little stiff. But at the end of the day, it's quieter, and like I said, for the show, you're gonna be just fine for 6.5 or 7 minutes. Actually, canter's not even that many minutes. Almost when you supple him, he drops the contact and drops the neck. So it's not that he actually connects where he actually drops the contact. So we need to have him take that power into the hand and feel that firmness a little bit. And then if you get a little too much weight, let me know, but I don't think right now you get too much. I almost think he gets too little. Okay, there, does he feel more even in both reins?
Yes.
Good. you're gonna bend in because you're moving the shoulders and the neck goes with the shoulders. So you still should be able to have that same feeling in both frames. Thinking of the same weight in both reins, same weight in both reins. Just go back to the idea that he's got to be even in both reins again, because it's like he gets in one and drops the other, and then he has this sort of ping pong thing going.
Yeah.
And the problem is, once they do that, we can't follow them that fast. You know, that kind of puts them in charge.
Yeah.
And then we're like, right, left, you know, trying to catch up. So it's sort of like it's never going to work. Because we're following them instead of them following us. So I think at that point, you just need to say, okay, let's go back to the whole same weight in both reins, and then think about using a little bit of flexion if you need to have him stretch a little more toward the light rein,
okay. But
not quite so much bend. He's almost using the bend in the neck now to get away from you. So let's do a little bit of trot. Gosh, are we hunting for dinner? Bit more power. There we go. That's it. There, good. Low in the neck. You've got to still stay stretched up and out a little to the snaffle. You know, if you think about what the bay horse was doing in the Piaf and Passage, if he wants to do a little bit that same thing, not quite as obvious as the brown horse who was just like pulling down, but just have to feel that he up a little more into the snaffle. Good. Good. So a little bit of shoulder in and then half pass left. Keep that same trot. Think a little bit about that inside front leg and the half pass. Not too much angle in the shoulder in. A little bit less angle. A teeny bit more bend, a little bit less angle.
Okay. Don't let him hide. Come on. Get him out in front of your leg. Don't let him hide in the snaffle. Yep.
Ten-meter circle. A little bit of bend. A little bit of bend. Keep that bend for the shoulder in. Uh-huh. That's better. Left, take your time for your preparation. Yes, good job. Mm-hmm. Yeah, good job. Good. And then afterwards, just a little forward. Yeah?
Okay.
In front. Uh-huh, good. Yes. Okay, now straight. Come on forward a little. Yeah, so you really have to say, at the end of your half pass, okay, what we're trying to do with that inside front leg maybe makes the trot a touch passage-y.
Okay.
Make sense? So at the end, you don't want to stay in that same trot. You want to go a little bit forward. Make sense?
Yep.
Yeah, okay. By next month, you should have this. So, in a maybe 10 days, yeah, good for you, exactly. In 10 days, you should be able to have that same feeling with a little bigger trot.
Okay.
Okay? But right now, I don't think you can. So, what we're doing a little bit with opening up those shoulders, I think it's good. Mm-hmm. Good, that's right. That's it. That's it. Very good. Super. Okay, have a little break. Good, Tara. Can you see in the mirror? That's what we want in the front. We want that inside front leg totally up, 100% extended, and then it goes over. Because you have so much more reach with the front legs, and then you're strengthening the outside hind. So the outside hind can really push you more sideways without pushing you downhill.
Okay.
Okay, so we do a little bit of the peepaw?
Yes, please.
Okay.
And it doesn't make you need to be quite so round either for the piano.
Good. Good.
very few horses. I mean, normally most horses you want to teach the piaf first and the massage. But with him, he can't figure out how to coordinate his front legs and his back legs very well. So the front legs are like walking and the hind legs are trotting. So he's got a real talent for massage. So I was like, okay, well, let's use that and make it smaller. And he started to figure out how to keep that diagonal. Yeah, so I think for him, like most horses, you wouldn't do that because then they never sit, but he sits really well, so the sitting's not the problem, it's just trying to figure out what's going on with his horse. He's like, I don't know.
Yeah,
yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you know, like I said, it's not something normally you do it that way, but sometimes you just have to do it that way. Mm-hmm. How are you?
Good.
Was that you out there killing dinner?
Brought to you by Equestrian Video Productions, LLC.